Ooh, it's hard to come behind that, isn't it? Praise the Lord. Today I want to share with you a message about Jesus being the light of the world. But before we go to the message, I want to show you a video. This video is powerful. Those that saw in the first service, they were like shaking their head, they couldn't believe it. But Jesus was having dialogue with the scribes and the Pharisees and those there, and he was explaining his position as being the light of the world. And it was a candid conversation that he was having. And I just felt led to show you this, not only because of what it means for the message, but just to show you the heartbeat of our Lord. Okay, so we'll get the lights, guys, and let's go ahead and see that video again.
I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
Thou bearest record of thyself. Thy record is not true.
Though I bear record of myself, yet my record is true. For I know whence I came and whither I go, but ye cannot tell whence I come and whither I go. Ye judge after the flesh. I judge no man. And yet if I judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone. But I, and the Father that sent me, it is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one that bear witness of myself, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me.
Where is thy Father?
Ye neither know me nor my Father. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. I go my way, and ye shall seek me, and shall die in your sins. Whither I go, ye cannot come. Ye are from beneath. I am from above. Ye are of this world. I am not of this world. I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins. For if you believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins.
Who art thou?
Even the same that I said unto you from the beginning. I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true. And I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him. When ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall ye know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself. But as my Father hath taught me, do always those things that please him. And if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free?
I know that ye are Abraham's seed, but ye seek to kill me, because my word hath no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. If ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me. A man that has told you the truth, which I have heard of God, why can you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. You are of your father, the devil. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. And because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. Verily, verily, I say unto you, if a man keep my saying, ye shall never see death.
Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead?
Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad.
And hast thou seen Abraham?
Verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am.
Thank you.
He has said he was the light of the world. Chris, get the lights on this side, will you please? That he was the light of the world. And he said also that the person that God sets free be free indeed. You know that this Christmas, Jesus wants nothing more than for you and I to be the lights of the world. Sharing that light with everybody we come in contact with. Family, friends, perhaps even a foe. Sharing the light of Jesus. Got a short Christmas, what I would call it a Christmas nugget. I want to share with you about him being the light of the world. Can you bow your heads with me? Let's ask God's blessings upon this nugget here this morning. Father God, in Jesus' name, we just saw a video that depicted your son and his expression of you, Father. We pray that each one of us today would have that candle, that light burning in our hearts today, the candle of Jesus Christ. And that God, as we hear this word today, may it only confirm what we already believe in our hearts. But for those of us who may not feel the same way as others about you, before they leave today, may they come to that understanding and to that place in you. May you, God, the light of the world, be our light today as we share it to others. Bless this message, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I want to share with you the Christmas story, if I can, just for a minute. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. It says, this is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother, Mary, was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Amen. Today, as we gather together before we celebrate Christmas, the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, hopefully we do so in a way that we're not being naive to the fact that we think everybody feels the same way we feel. Unfortunately, the world at large does not feel about Jesus as we feel about Jesus. Today, as we celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and we believe that he is the reason for the season, we should be aware that many people don't believe that truth. That many people believe the season is totally different to them than it is to you and I. Full of their festivities and their lights and the gift exchanging and things of that nature. But today I'm here to tell you that without Jesus Christ, there'd be no Christmas. I boldly proclaim to you today that without Christ, there is no Christmas.
That's right.
Without Christ, there is no gift exchanges, there is no lights, there is no festivities, there is no frosting, there is no Santa.
That's right.
Without Christmas, Jesus is the reason for the season.
That's right.
Always has been, always will be. Mm-hmm. Today, we live in a world where there's over 7.5 billion people with millions of different philosophies, ideologies, and beliefs. To think that that everybody believes the same way would be a stretch. But I'm here to tell you, proclaim it boldly and confidently, that despite all these different views, not every view is correct. But the correct view today, not because I believe it, because it bears witness to the fact, and that view is that Jesus Christ is not only the babe in the manger, he is Emmanuel, God with us, King of kings and Lord of lords.
Hallelujah.
He is the one that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess.
That's right.
That Jesus Christ is Lord.
Yes.
You see, the world may seem to be out of control, and it may seem to be going down a road that you and I can't understand anymore. Many of us have said if my grandfathers were still alive today, they would shake their heads on how far our world has changed. But I wanted to know this Christmas season that God's in perfect control of planet Earth. He's got everything under control and everything's working to plan this Christmas season. They say that Jesus is the reason for the season, but I'm here to tell you that Jesus is the reason for everything. Everything holds together because of Jesus, and there is nothing that holds together if it wasn't for Jesus. You see, Jesus came into the world not only to be the Savior of the world, but He came into the world to be the light of the world. The world is a beautiful place. God made it beautiful, but it's also a dark place, a cold place, a callous place. But Jesus came to give that earth, this place called the world we live in, a light, a warmthness, if you will. A love that it doesn't experience. That's found in the person of Jesus. That's found in the person of each one of you who believe in Him. We have been given an awesome privilege, and that is to be the light bearers of the one that came for you and I, that being Jesus. There are references of Jesus being the light of the world in Scripture, and I want to share some of it with you. Isaiah used this reference in his prophecy about the Messiah. Isaiah 9 verse 2 says, "The people who walked in darkness have been given a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of death," he says, "upon them a light has shined." Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, he prophesied in Luke chapter 1, verse 78 and 79. He says, "Though the tender mercies of our God, with which the day spring from on high has visited us, to give us light to those who sit in darkness and the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the ways of peace." And it says here that even Simeon, the one I talked about a couple of weeks ago, the one that came when Jesus was dedicated at the temple, Simeon in Luke chapter 2, verse 32 says, "A light to bring revelation to the Gentiles has come, and the glory," he says, "of your people, Israel." And even right here in the New Testament, Matthew talks about it in Matthew 4, 16. He says, "The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and upon those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned." Today I want you to know that despite the world we live in, the world of racism, the world of hatred, the world of despair, the world of economic collapse, it seems like, and the world of terrorism, in the midst of all this darkness, the light still shines, the light of Jesus Christ. A light that the pits of hell cannot dispel. It's the light of Jesus. And that light will always shine as long as there are believers on the earth. As long as there is a Holy Spirit guiding and leading believers. As long as there are believers who will stand on the Word of God and believers who will be boldly come into the house of God and proclaim from the rooftop that Jesus Christ is born. The light will always shine in the dark places of our lives. You see, today we are gathered in His name, not just to honor Him and to remember Him, but we are gathered in His name to display light. Each one of us have light. Each one of us who have Jesus Christ living in our heart have light. I was sharing with the group this morning that for years as a young associate, I used to go to hospitals and visit people in the hospital and visit people in the nursing homes. And they were, if you've been in the hospital, you know it could be gloomy, it could be dark, it could be scary. But every time that we came into that room, on behalf of the great physician, not as a physician, we walked into that room and, man, we brought light to the room. And you saw people's whole disposition, everything they had about them, their whole countenance changed right before us. Why? Because we were displaying the light of Jesus.
That's right.
And the light uncovers darkness and the light brings forth life.
That's right.
And that's what you and I are supposed to do. Be people who present the light to a world that is dying. Light to a world that is dark and cold. Light to a world who has no hope. That's what you and I are to do. Today I want to ask you, can we determine to embrace the light in the life of Jesus as we enter into this Christmas season? Better yet, can we determine to embrace the life and the light of Jesus as we enter into 2015? A brand new year of challenges. You see, if we're not careful here, we can be deceived and say that all 2015 is going to be is another representation of what 2014 was. And how many of you know that for some of us, 2014 wasn't a very good year?
Yeah.
I'm here to tell you, thank you, Jesse. I'm here to tell you that I believe in my heart of hearts that 2015 could be the greatest year we've had as a church body.
Amen.
It could be the greatest year in your health and your finances and your relationships. In the raising of your families and your church and your ministries and your jobs and your schools, it has the possibility to be the greatest year of our lives.
Amen.
And it starts by you and I displaying the life and the light of Jesus Christ.
Right.
It's by you and I standing on the light and not standing on the darkness.
Right.
But declaring and shouting from the rooftops that Jesus lives.
Mm-hmm.
Where is he at? He lives in me. He lives in you.
Yes.
They said to Jesus in the video, "Where is your Father? Show us your Father." The world is asking that same question. Where is the Father? Show us. When he sees you and I, they see the Father. Because he lives inside each one of us. Don't we understand? The light of the world. You see, John 1, verse 7 says, "But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another," he says, "and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin." If we would just walk in the light and the love of Jesus Christ. Back when Jesus came, Mary and Joseph, they were prophesied by the angels about the coming child, the Messiah. I'm sure that they, even after they heard the prophecy, I'm sure they didn't truly grasp what was happening to them. I'm sure they didn't truly grasp the responsibility, the parental responsibility they had of raising the Messiah. I'm sure that when you and I gave our hearts to Jesus Christ and we took on the label as a Christian, I'm sure many of us didn't truly count the cost of being a Christian. Many of us have experienced things and said that we were bold enough to say it, we keep it to ourselves, but if we were bold enough to say it out loud, we would say, "I didn't count on all this as being a Christian. I thought it would be easier than this. I thought people would embrace what I'm about to sell. I thought when I talked to my family about Jesus, they would just gravitate to me." But they're not. They're shunning me. They're dispelling my light, and they're covering up their darkness. This is not what I counted on. This is not what I bargained for. I'm sure that even though the angel talked to Mary and Joseph, they looked back and they said, "This is not what we had thought when we were going to be the parents of the Messiah." And I'm sure that they raised the boy Jesus to be a carpenter's son. I'm sure as time went on and the beginning, when the kings went away and the shepherds went away and the star ran away, I'm sure they got back to normality and they began to raise him as a normal child and forgot all the prophetic words spoken about Jesus. But it was until that day when he was 12 years of age and they had lost track of him for a couple days. And they went back to the temple to find him, and they found him there talking to the priests and the scribes. They said, "Why did you worry us, son? We were looking forward to where you were at. We lost you. Why did you worry your mom and dad?" And Jesus gave them a reminder that day who he was. He said, "Did you not know I had to be about my Father's business?" And that day, folks, come crashing in with the prophecies of the angels, prophecies of him being the light of the world, the Messiah, the Savior of the world, and they realized that they had a great responsibility then to see it through. I'm here to tell you today that you and I have a responsibility to see it through. I was sharing this morning that what we are as Christians, we're like in a relay race. In a relay race, they pass that baton off to the next runner. And the last runner, he is the anchor man. He's the one that brings it home. Folks, we're the anchor people of God. We're the ones bringing it home until Jesus comes. And our responsibility is to display the light of Jesus Christ to all the dying world because Jesus is coming soon. We're the anchor people of God. We have a great responsibility to display the great good news of God's word and his light to a dying world. But so often, we got born again several years ago, several months ago, several even days ago, but so quickly, we have lost our fervor. So quickly, we have lost the excitement of it all, and we have lost our responsibility to be sharing the light of Jesus. Hopefully, this Christmas season, we can get that flame rekindled and fan the flame within each one of us and begin to understand that each one of us, this Christmas season, has a great responsibility to display the light and the love of God to everyone that we come in contact with. I'm going to visit family. We are in back in Tampa. I can tell you, our family, for the most part, do not walk in the light of God the way maybe some of us do. And it's not to sling mud at them. They're where they're supposed to be, or we are where we're supposed to be. But our job, my wife and our job, and our kids' job, is to share the love and the light of Jesus to them. And when their time is right, hopefully they'll come in to embrace it. And that is your job as well, to share the love and the light of Jesus to those that don't know that light and the love that you and I know personally. It says here in John chapter 3, verse 19 to 21, that this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light. It says, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen, that they may have been done in God. Think about this. It says here that this is what the condemnation is, that the light has come, but people select darkness instead. But the Bible tells you and I that there is no condemnation for those of us in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. That means that we have embraced the light of God. We have taken it inside of us, and that light is inside of each one of us who believe. So because of that, you and I, not based on our merit, not based on how much we've done or given or what we represent, but because of that basis of our belief, we don't have to walk in condemnation. We can walk around in the gift of God, in the light of salvation. There's only those who reject it. And the bad thing about rejecting that light is this. It is a free gift. It's a free gift. And I counsel so many people, and they always tell me the same thing. Pastor, the reason why I don't accept it, because I don't want to give up things that I have in my life. I don't want to give it up. And I tell them something that always blows them away. I say, when I gave Jesus up to my life, and I put him into my heart, I never, ever gave up anything. It kind of flew away. See, that's the biggest problem we think. I like my dad, and if I give my heart to Jesus, I got to make radical changes. You don't have to do anything, folks. You come as you are to Jesus. And he and you will have an abiding relationship, and he will begin to take you on your own personal journey. Your journey is not my journey. It's your journey. And your journey, if you'll be true to your journey, will end up in eternal life.
That's right.
And he'll be the one that will direct you on what to keep in your life and not to keep in your life,
right,
according to his word.
Yes.
If we would start to understand that we're all on different journeys and different paths with God, I think we can win more souls for Jesus.
Amen.
He says in John 8:12, Jesus spoke to them and saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. That's important for us to hear this morning. If you and I call ourselves believer, doesn't mean we're perfect. Doesn't mean you have perfect church attendance. Don't mean you always give faithfully in the offering bag. What it means is you believe Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you and I are a believer, then we should at least attempt to walk in the light, not in the darkness. The darkness has no place with a Christian. It's only the light. And every time that we sense the darkness is creeping in, it's our job to dispel it as quick as possible and begin to walk again in the light. Don't let condemnation rob you of the blessings of God. That's what we do a lot. Pastor, you haven't seen me at church lately because I kind of fell off a little bit. I've been kind of doing some things I'm not very proud of. Well, I appreciate your honesty, but all you had to do is give it over to Jesus and get back into church again and get back to where you were. Don't walk around in condemnation. There's no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus.
That's right.
You see, he says in Matthew 5, 14 through 16, you are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. He said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good deeds or works and glorify your Father in heaven. You know what he's saying here? That you and I are not to hide that light. You have a treasure inside of you. It's not to be hidden. It's not to be kept to yourself. It's to be given away to all that you come in contact with. You see, the world is going through what I would call walking through a hazy maze. You ever walk through your house at night You work the double shift, you work the night shift, you don't want to wake up your kids and your spouse, and you walk in, you don't turn on the lights, and you're trying to navigate through your house, and your wife changed the furniture around, and you're bumping into things. And you're making all kinds of noise, you're racking, and before you know it, there's all kind of chaos in your house. And your wife taking out the pistol, thinking there's a robber there, there's all kinds of stuff. That's where the world's at right now. The world's in darkness. They're stumbling over things, they're running into things, because they can't see things for what they really are. But we who are the light of Jesus Christ are supposed to be the ones that lead the way, that show them that there is a better way of living and a better way of acting in our lives. The psalmist says in Psalm 119, 105, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." I put this in here, and I was sharing this morning that I had an intriguing conversation with some friends last night. And in the conversation, we were all agreeing on this. You know, if we folks, the Bible said, if we would draw nigh unto God, he would draw nigh unto us.
Yes.
But if we resist the devil, he will flee.
Amen.
There's a thing here, the best way to increase church attendance, the best way to increase blessings in our lives, the best way to increase the light that we have to illuminate is by drawing nigh unto him. And the way we draw nigh unto him is by drawing nigh unto his word. Once we begin to spend time in the Word of God, when we begin to spend time in prayer, before you know it, you don't have to get a phone call from the pastor encouraging you to come to church. You're just kind of like a rubber band. You kind of get pulled in that direction. As you and I get into His Word this new year and begin to pray and to seek His face, we'll start seeing our light shine more. And what it does is, it'll be like a magnet. It'll draw you closer to the things of God, not afar from them. Next week, we're going to be giving you a gift from us to you. We ordered for the entire church. We got these calendars. Beautiful calendar, right, Tom? Beautiful calendars. But this big has our name on it, and it has you can read through the Bible the whole year to them, and it's got a calendar for your own personal dates. It is a beautiful read through your Bible for the year. We're going to give each and every one of you one next week because we want all of you to take the time to read God's Word for yourself throughout the whole year because we believe it'll be a light onto your path. We believe that. As I try to close up here this morning, Christmas sure is the celebration of the birth and save of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But it's also more than that. It's a chance for all of us to shine our lights to the world. It's a chance for all of us to reflect and look back at where we are with God. And it's a chance to once again go all the way back to the babe in the manger and look at the precious gift that we have. A lot of us sometimes take that gift for granted, do we not? We forget the wonderful gift that God has given to us in the person of Jesus. At this time, I'd like to ask y'all to get your candles ready. And I've asked a few of the ushers just to begin to light the outside candle and have you guys light each other. Pat, y'all light the person next to you all the way down. And ask, we are lighting this candle of Jesus Christ. I'd like the lights to be out too, guys. Luke, kill the lights back there. Kill the lights on this side. And I'd like us, as my wife sings, my wife's going to sing for us today. And as we are, hold off on the passing, guys. That's good right there. As you begin to sing, I'd like you to go ahead and begin to light the person next to you. And we can even stand. I'd like you to stand if you can. In the lighting.
There is a candle in every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold. There is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle. Confused and torn. Oh.
light exposes the darkness. Each one of these candles represents us, the light of Jesus. And as we go and we share our lights to this darkened world, we too begin to poke holes in the darkness for Jesus Christ. As you hold your candle, I'd like you just to repeat after me. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
As we hold this candle.
As we hold this candle.
It represents the light.
It represents the light.
And you are the light.
And you are the light.
That lives in us.
That lives in us.
Forgive us of our sins.
Forgive us of our sins.
And help us.
And help us.
Not to walk.
Not to walk.
In condemnation.
In condemnation.
But to walk.
But to walk.
In the light.
In the light.
In the love.
In the love.
Of Jesus Christ.
Of Jesus Christ.
Help us.
Help us.
This Christmas.
This Christmas.
To share the light.
To share the light.
Of God's love.
Of God's love.
With all we come in contact with.
With all we come in contact with.
For this we pray.
For this we pray.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. I'd like to read a scripture over you before we close today. Numbers 6, 24 through 26 says, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you. May he be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you. And may he give you peace. Merry Christmas. God bless you. Turn the lights on, guys. You can greet each other in the Lord. God bless you. Have a wonderful Christmas. Know that you are loved by God and by those of us that join praise fellowship. You can keep your candle. You can keep it as a souvenir. It's not an eatable candle. You can't eat it. You're not being available, guys.
Hey, blow your candle out, all right.